All right, as the last video for today, let me briefly highlight some other types or variants of autoencoders. So we can also add dropout to our autoencoder. So here, if these are fully connected or convolutional layers, we can add dropout layers, dropout 1D or 2D, and this will cause the network, the encoder, to learn redundant features. Same with a decoder, because it won't be able now to rely on particular features to be present, because as you recall from the dropout lecture, features will be dropped randomly, so it can't rely on a certain feature being there, and then it will maybe be learned to be more robust. So you can use the idea of using dropout also to construct a so-called denoising autoencoder. So in the very first video of this lecture, I showed you this example where there was an autoencoder denoising medical images. So if you add dropout directly after the input, it will essentially add noise to your image, because right now then half of the pixels will be removed, right? So you have this noisy representation of this input. But if you still have your reconstruction loss between those two, so if this is your reconstruction loss computed between these two, for instance the 2 norm or mean squared error, then it will learn essentially how to ignore the noise, right? Because the autoencoder itself, the encoder only sees these noisy images, and then it will learn how to remove the noise because it wants to minimize the error between the not denoised input and the output, right? So in this way you can train autoencoders to denoise images. You can also train it for doing other tricks like colorizing images and so forth. So there are different things you can do with these autoencoders. You can also have a sparse autoencoder if it's desired. So in a sparse autoencoder, more than half, so by definition a sparse matrix is a matrix where more than half of the entries are zero, and you can also have then or learn a representation where more than half of these are zero. So how you can do that is by adding a L1 penalty. So if you recall in the regularization lecture a long time ago, we talked about L2 and L1 penalties. So if you're familiar from other classes, that's similar to how L2 regularization, rich regression and lasso regression work in the context of linear regression. So we have this penalty term on the weights. So here it's the absolute value for the L1, and for L2 it's the squared value. And this will, if you recall, cause this constraint optimization. So we have still here our reconstruction loss between the input and the output. So this is the reconstruction loss, and now this is the L1 penalty. So it will try to keep the weights small. At the same time, it will also try, so here it's not the weights, here it's the encoded space, sorry. So it's trying to keep the encoded space, the values, small, while also still minimizing the reconstruction loss, and it will result in sparse embeddings if that's desired. There might be an application where that's desired, I don't know. Okay, so lastly, the variational autoencoder. This is more interesting now. So I don't want to go over it too much because it would be kind of a spoiler, because we will have a whole lecture, the next lecture, dedicated to this. So in a nutshell, this is an approach where we essentially learn the autoencoder such that this embedded vector will represent a Gaussian probability density, and we can achieve that by also having an additional loss. So here previously we had this L1 penalty added to the loss. Now what we have is we have a KL divergence term added to the loss. So here this would be our, we have both a reconstruction term and the KL divergence term. So for the reconstruction term, we could use like here the binary cross entropy or negative log likelihood, so it's the same thing. However, we could also use the L2 or MSE. Technically, if we just want to create a good variational autoencoder, it doesn't matter. In fact, I would say L2 and MSE work even better. And yeah, so we will talk about this in more detail than in the next lecture because, well, the lecture is already very long, and if we have a dedicated lecture to that, why talking about it in one slide if I have, or if I can have 30 slides, right? So with that, this is maybe a teaser for the topic that we will have next week. So okay, so then that's it for today.